I was born and brought up in Lexington, Kentucky. Kentucky's a sort of southern mountain hillbilly state. Sort of on impulse, one weekend, my friend Tom Miller and I decided to leave school without notification. So we sort of jumped the fence and started hitchhiking south. We ended up getting arrested pretty quickly. For me, the decision was irrevocable. I wasn't staying at home. I just turned 17, and I had $100 in my pocket and a bus ticket to New York City.
I was saying, let me out of here before I was even born. It's such a gamble when you get a face. It's fascinating to observe what the mirror does, but when I dine it for the wall, that I've set a place. I belong to the blank generation.
When I came to New York, what I wanted to do was make a life for myself as a poet. When you're that age, you don't have any sense of history, you know? The world was kind of ours to take. Within a couple of years, Tom came to New York.
I remember being in New York the first month thinking how great it is that nobody gives the slightest shit about you or what you do. And I found this really freeing.
Tom and I both had this sort of weakness for the French poets of the 19th century. I mean, the first two that always come to mind are Lautrémont and Baudelaire for me. It was urban and cruel and unsentimental. And, you know, we also both felt sort of separate from any existing kind of social circles or any kind of society. What was really in the air and permeating the kind of the youth culture at that time were the Beats. Kerouac and Ginsberg and Corso and Burroughs.
And a saucer. I knew it was coming. I wanted to be in on it. I knew that it was coming. I wanted to be in on it. I knew it came and went and I wasn't in on it. I was at this party. All I knew was James Brown and somebody put on Third Stone from the Sun. Everybody was looking at me. So I put out my whistle, the one shaped like a cigar with black pickups.
You know, I grew up in a rural community and there was nowhere to go and everything took, you had to walk 4 or 5 miles to go here or there. I mean, yeah, everything you did, you were made fun of because the way you looked. You know, even if you were totally innocent, you know, just walking around with a book of Rimbaud poems and, you know, not combing my hair or looking exactly like everybody else. I wasn't even rebellious. I just lived in my own world, but it put everybody off. So to me, New York was freedom.
This is the first place I came to in New York, was the Chelsea Hotel, because Dylan Thomas, like, was one of my big heroes. And so, like, Dylan Thomas used to hang out on this very roof. And I'm sure, like, he threw up a couple, one too many rums or something off this roof. Looked at the old Empire State Building right here. And I've always, liked to be where the big guys were, you know.
And in New York, there were a lot of people with ideas who were trying to do things. And so you build friendships based on work. It's a lot of energy, camaraderie energy.
Yeah, hey.
Put them up.
That almost hurts.
We were pretty well inseparable for 2 or 3 years there, you know, and we had our own whole private language, you know, sort of. And we would sit up all night and hand the typewriter back and forth, writing collaborations. I eventually published a book. It was sort of the last writing right before we formed a band. The writing and publishing got to feel too obscure and esoteric and isolated and separated because most people didn't read.
I was a drummer once. I saw all the film around me, all the film, all the microphone, film was coloring my, all the celluloid, all the black, triplets, everything was black and shining, everything was hard, I felt it, he felt it hard in his hand, started.
What Patti brought to poetry was a sense of performance and kind of street language. You could understand her poems. Her poems were almost like songs.
King Curtis, it's stabbed in the heart, south, menu, it's stabbed, on, day, home, gone, down.
I quickly became unsatisfied with my own myself. I wanted some sound behind it. And I met Lenny and asked him to interpret what I was doing with his electric guitar.
Yes, me well. I wasn't saying too much neither. I was a real moral asshole, a hard-working schoolgirl. I feel working in a factory, I gotta earn my
dough. And it just evolved. And, you know, it was like done with like joyful abandon and a lot of innocence and without precedent. So, I mean, we were just making it up as we went along.
And so it very quickly grew into kind of a musical act as opposed to a poetry act.
Mr. Death, I'll a kiss, Oscar Wilde, Ja lives, Mr. Thorpe, the time is now, the time is now. The boy looked at Johnny, Johnny wanted to run. Johnny wanted to move, but the movie kept moving as planned. The boy gripped Johnny, he pressed him against a locker. He drove it in, he drove it home, he drove it deep in Johnny. The boy disappeared, Johnny fell on his knees, started crushing his head against a locker. Started it, crushing his head against the locker. Started living mistakenly.
You can look in the Village Voice now and see hundreds of places to play, but we really came up in a time where there wasn't anywhere to play. There was literally nowhere to play.
My idea was that we find a place that would let us play one day a week so that people could just tell each other, you know, go there at Sunday night. I mean, if we told a failing bar, if they would allow us to play music there, they'd be selling more drinks than they would have otherwise.
One day, a group of guys saw me putting up something on the ladder, and they asked what was happening here, and I told them what I was doing. And that was Tom Verlaine and Richard Hell, Richard Lloyd of television, which subsequently became the first of the new wave of rock bands that played here.
It was a bikers hangout, and so we played there every Sunday night, and we started getting the audience.
My little Johnny Jew, oh, he's so cool.
What I remember is there'd maybe be 20 people, and the next week maybe there'd be 30, and just word of mouth. And at one point, I think the New York Times actually wrote up a club on the Bowery, which is, nobody lived on the Bowery, went to the Bowery. It was all Skid Row hotels, alcoholics laying on the street and stuff.
And William Burroughs.
And William Burroughs lived in the bunker, actually, next door.
There was a place right above CBGB's, it's still there, called the Palace Hotel. It was a bum hotel. When a bum would steal another bum's pair of shoes, they would throw him out the window. So you would be literally standing there on the sidewalk in front of CBGB's on a hot summer night, and a bum would come flying out the window of the Palace Hotel and splatter on the sidewalk.
It was also incredibly cheap to live. My apartment was $42 a month, and so you didn't have to worry about getting full-time jobs. Now it's also expensive. I don't know anybody can come here and live that kind of way.
Okay, I'll give you something to remember. Your mom thinks I'm going to marry you.
It was at the height of what they called white flight. You know, everybody who was white moved to the suburbs. But we all grew up in the suburbs and moved to the dirty city because it was much more interesting than the suburbs, which are like the most horrible invention in America, you know? It was our parents' dream and our nightmare.
I came to New York in April of 1974. In January, I got involved with Richard Hell, and I was living with him, and his band Television was playing at CBGB's. And the manager, Terry Ork, asked me if I would do the door at CB's. And people would sometimes call up from out of state, from far away, if they wanted to hear a certain band, and they would ask me to, like, hold the phone up so they could hear the band that was playing that night. At that time, well, actually, yes, around 1975, I began to photograph the bands in CBGB's.
We got attention right away. We were written about in the papers. It became the most interesting place to go on weekends because there was nothing remotely like what we were doing.
This is a little plea expressing man's desire to orally know a photon.
I remember that feeling, you know, of the first rehearsals and the incredible thrill of suddenly doing it yourself, you know.
The physicality of performing is really inspiring when you first do it. Becomes suddenly so physical. You know, I mean, everybody was constantly breaking strings.
I remember seeing them once early on, and Patti Smith was like two tables away on top of a table dancing wildly. And they came off the stage with their fingers bleeding. They're playing so hard, you know.
The name Television was definitely meant also as kind of a provocation, you know, because it was embracing something that, you know, all the intelligentsia, the cognoscenti, right, rejected as being vulgar, right?
The most defining characteristic, really, which was the short hair that Television had, it seems very like not a big thing now, but back in a time when having long hair was basically, you know, if you were counterculture in any way or rock and roll in any way, you just had long hair. That was it.
You got to remember, in the early 70s, rock and roll became like religious. You know? These great gurus. And everyone was extremely serious and extremely pretentious. I've been through the desert on a horse with no name. You know, America. The name of the band was America, and the song is A Horse with No Name. I've been through a desert on a horse with no name. It felt good to be out of the rain. That had absolutely nothing to do with my life. Well, New York doesn't breed that kind of optimism, you know. But, you know, by the end of the 60s and the 70s, it become arena rock, stadium rock, you know, where you played for 50,000 people and you got in a limousine and you drove to the next one or flew to the next one in your own private plane. So rock and roll became very removed from everyday life.
And I saw other people starting bands without being virtuosos. People like the Stooges and the Dolls and the Velvet Underground were about frustration and anger and aggression, but, you know, they're all pretty funny, too. It seemed as if it was music that was made by human beings talking to other human beings.
The Stooges were threatening. They were aesthetically threatening, and if you look very closely at their lifestyle, they were threatening to themselves. They were destroying themselves. They were a dangerous little outfit. For the Stooges was a struggle. Their house was always being torn down. They never had any money. They never could get a gig. Everybody hated them. And then they got into drugs and they got themselves in more trouble. And it's lucky that they got out those first two albums before real calamity hit. They didn't see themselves in the spectrum of any bands. And now it turns out that the music they were making was cosmically wonderful.
To the stage and listen to Iggy and the Stooges. she had a TV. Ow, beef. Yo.
It was extra nervous power.
There goes Iggy right into the crowd.
Damn!
We've lost audio on him. This seems like a good chance to get a message in.
Maniacs are the iron-on transfers in color. Iron-on, lift off. Get Maniacs.
Since we broke away for our message, Iggy has been in the crowd and out again 3 different times. We seem to have lost him, and we're trying to get a light on him now.
Till it blow, it went.
It was the most sublime sound I thought that human beings had ever made. That was a revolution in sound.
I get a lot of my influence like from the Electric Shavers and the industrialism in Detroit. But what I heard, you know, wandering around was, there are 10 cars, 20 cars.
Do you feel you've influenced anybody?
I think I helped wipe out the 60s.
I heard there was a band called the New York Dolls singing songs about pills and singing songs about trash. I just thought that was really cool.
The music was very much that 2.5 minute song. It was very, very hard driving rock and roll. You know, they were dressing in these high heels and, you know, outrageous bouffant hair that thought it was kind of funny what they were doing.
10 years later, you couldn't come out with a band and not wear lipstick and false eyelashes. But then it was not acceptable. They were fags. They were so unfag. It was the unfaggiest band that there was. To be condemned commercially for something that you're not was kind of tragic, and so they sunk into alcohol and the heroin oblivion.
The New York Dolls, that was a band here, it was so of a loss, you know, and they were doing this for everybody in town. No band could compete with them. They were the best, the coolest. Then after they broke up, people tried to start bands to have something to do and, you know, try to recreate that scene.
Don't fuck with us, sweetheart.
This is the Bowery. This is where it all happened many years ago at CBGB's. Some things never change.
And I really enjoyed, you know, all the people that hung around, and this was like a place where you could just come to. I lived 2 blocks away, so it was like, you know, it was a local bar. It was like, you know, the bar on the end of your block. 30,000 bands or something must have played in here, and it's pretty much the same. I mean, the feeling of this part of the room, this area.
Richard Hell, he was the first person to introduce me to it. I can see time everywhere I went, I had 16 millimeter camera, and I used to come in here and just film the bands.
Are you a boy? Tell me, are you a girl? With that bleach blonde hair?
I didn't have a sync sound camera, but it didn't matter to me that much. It wasn't like I was out to make a documentary about punk. I didn't even know what I was doing.
I can't seem to face up to the fact. I'm tense and nervous and I can't relax. I can't sleep cause my bed's on fire. Don't touch me, I'm a real live wire. Psycho killer, qu'est-ce que c'est?
We didn't have like any money, but we found a place where we could get an editing table for $25 for 24 hours. We went in there and we took some amphetamines, and at the end of 24 hours we had this film, Blank Generation.
Her spoon within my only belong to me. Me. People say beware, but I don't care.
So other bands that felt something in common with us, you know, that felt comfortable at that club, started showing up, asking for dates too.
Hey ho, let's go. Hey ho, let's go. Hey ho, let's go. Hey ho, let's go. On the Tuesday night, don't miss our watch. Get to this and that night. Three bucks. Falling in the backseat.
Like kind of rock and roll people, and we weren't growing up too much. Now, we were all in other bands, and I think by the time we were 19 or something, we were played, you know? And Johnny Ramone was the oldest one, and we thought it was very bad to play in a band, and we tried to get jobs. And then we lost the jobs, and but somehow we would always go to 48th Street to the guitar stores and then have a beer, you know, and stuff and talk about. And then we just started playing because we don't know any better to do anything else.
Hey, ho, let's go! Hey, ho, let's go! Hey, ho, let's go!
When I first saw the Ramones, that really, it was like, wow, this is reduced to something pure. You know, all the extraneous stadium rock trappings and virtuoso masturbatory guitar playing was pretty much eliminated completely by the Ramones. They kind of distilled it all.
Beat on the brat, beat on the brat, beat on the brat with a baseball bat was how I grew up. I think it was also the first time people were exposing the other side of America, you know, how we grew up. And that people were divorced, and your father was drunk, and your mother was out getting laid by somebody, and you were wondering, you know, what it all meant. And that's what punk sang about. And the Ramones did it very funny, you know.
They had an element of humor, but they weren't playing it like it was humor.
was so reductive and powerful. To be a manager, and they said, can you buy us a set of drums? You know, so I flew down to Florida, got the money from my mother, and I was their manager. That's all I had to do.
And I didn't really know what a verse or a chorus was till about 1983 or four, you know, and I never learned the music on the bass, so I left the Ramones. I used to think then it wasn't like music. You know, I was sort of like worrying. But later on, when I knew more about music, and then I said, oh yes, there's a verse, of course, it's properly arranged, you know.
They take the elevator in the back to the fourth floor.
To this day, one of the most intense violent punk rock things I've ever seen was Alan Vega playing with Suicide in 1976. It was Alan Vega wearing an old lady's wig with a big scar on his face and white makeup, and Martin Rev with big bug-eyed shades playing this weird Moog synthesizer at the most incredible volume. I mean, it was just like...
He's a little so cute. Sneaking right around in a blue jumpsuit. Who's riding a motorcycle hero? Beep, 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 he's a blazing away.
And Alan Vega was so into what he was doing, and he was just screaming in the microphone, and if you didn't pay attention to him, he would come over to you in the audience and get his microphone cord and wrap it around your neck and just pull, and he would choke you and he would scream in your face and then grab your hair and just throw you on the ground. And we were just like freaked out, and we kept moving back and back, and people were picking up their tables and blocking the stage so the singer wouldn't come near them. And we were like, you know, 18-year-old kids. We ran out and we got into our car and we ran home. And all the while we were thinking like we were gonna come back.
Like America was killing itself or something, you know, with the Vietnam War and everything. And it just made perfect sense to us. That name just made total perfect sense to us. Little do we know, we pretty much chose the worst name of any band. It gave us hell. Even though we really wanted to call the band Life, you know, but who's going to buy a band called Life? But it turned out to be the worst thing we could have ever done, man. It kept us off the radio.
Remember once I was watching him here at Seabees, and Martin Rev is up there playing, and Alan Vega just drops the mic on the floor, as he often did. the big thud, and he walks off the stage. They were getting a lot of beer cans thrown at them and people spitting on them and stuff, which I don't know if that was an appreciation or, you know, probably. But anyway, Alan Vega walked off the stage, and there used to be a payphone right off stage. And Martin Rev is still up there, you know, ducking beer cans going past his head. And Alan Vega's like 5 feet away on a payphone, like calling up his girlfriend or something, in the middle of their set, you know. That impressed me deeply, you know.
Most bands try to entertain, but Marty and I's idea was not to entertain. What happened was they came in from the street, they got a worse street than what was out on the street. So that really threw them for a loop, the fact that they weren't going to be entertained. You know, they were going to get a slice of life.
These girls falling over on volumes.
Yeah, and there was always a lot of vomit and piss all over the place, and dogs dead, dead cats, and.
This is true, actually.
But the one thing I like about CBGBs, I can say I played there recently. Something about it was pretty much the same. It really hasn't changed all that much.
That's true.
Brief period of time before a style started developing out of CBGB's, the bands were all really different from each other, you know, almost consciously so. And everybody found a different piece of territory and embarked upon it.
Really developed their own following, and there was some overlap, but there was also, you know, would be very distinct crowds of people there on different nights of the week, depending who was playing.
As soon as things started happening, Tom and I started falling away from each other. You know, I mean, my influence and involvement with television lasted like 6 months, you know. I thought I could really use a band that was just direct, noisy, aggressive. I left the group and made a group with Johnny Thunders.
We write this next one with D.D. Ramone. Thank you, D.D., wherever you are. 1, 2, 3, 4!
Heartbreakers lasted about a year, too. I left that band and formed Richard Hell and the Borders.
Hey,
Chris Parker, who was like maybe 15 at the time, who was in my first film, Permanent Vacation. I used to hang out with him a lot here, and it was all sort of combined with the whole spirit of that period, I think. You didn't have to be a virtuoso filmmaker. It was like the spirit was more important than the technique. Back then that I met Amos Poe and Eric Mitchell and people that were making really kind of street guerrilla films at the time.
Debbie, Harry, and Chris Stein were really into movies. We all, you know, we always talked about making movies together. And then Debbie did, you know, cameos in my first two films.
Hotel Bilbao, amour, Nassau, Bischof, the Comte. Hotel Bilbao, amour, Bischof, Munich, the Comte. Hotel Bilbao, amour, Elba, Brazil, the Comte. Hotel Bilbao, amour, Ich hatte nie geschaut. Ich weiß ja nicht, ob ich in Graz, aber es geht es da. Es war das Schönste. Es war das Schönste. Es war das Schönste auf der Welt.
Thanks, Soldier.
It was pretty exciting at the time. It was very exciting to find something that was like sort of a genuinely a kind of subculture.
My original excitement about things that were happening in that period was that exploratory aspect that sometimes on wonderful, really great nights might get into the realm of mystical or spiritual.
Somebody's
at CBGB's, I remember someone saying to me, you haven't read Last Exit to Brooklyn? You know, you're an asshole if you haven't read Last Exit to Brooklyn. At which I went out the next day and bought Last Exit to Brooklyn. I mean, people read William Burroughs and wanted to become junkies, you know. You know, they wanted that danger, and it was dangerous.
Drugs were one of the things that were forbidden by the authorities, and we were rejecting the idea of authority. There was William Burroughs and the Velvet Underground, and not to mention all the way back to the French poets. You know, Baudelaire writes about hashish, and Cocteau was an opium addict.
You had to go down to the East Village, and or, you know, to Alphabet City, and some guy would steer you through a hole in the brick wall, and then you went up some broken stairs, and then you'd be lining up in the dark inside a burnt-out building. Then as you got to the door, you slipped the guy money under the door, and then these bags would come out, and you went downstairs, and there'd be a guy selling you needles for $3 a needle, $2 a needle, you know, new needles, you know, sealed. And there was a whole thing about, like, avoiding the cops, and, you know, getting the heroin at the time was half the high, in a way.
You'd run into people, you'd meet people, and the conversations were not limited to music, so you talked to musicians about films, and you talked to writers about music, and Andy was always around, too. I met him at CBGB's the first time I ever met him, so he was always around checking everything out. And it was cool too, because back then it wasn't like a big deal if Andy Warhol showed up. I mean, the factory was an important scene that certainly influenced the punk, whatever they call it now, this scene in the mid to late 70s.
Taking a silk screen of the electric chair and saying this is art was really kind of important. The images didn't have to be nice in order to be art. It's important to note the Velvet Underground's collaboration with Andy Warhol. Andy set the look, you know, the sunglasses, the hair, and the black leather jacket. And also Warhol's work ethic, too, where he told Lou Reed to write a song every day. There's a very famous quote. Someone said, you know, only, you know, 2,000 people bought a Velvet Underground record, but every one of those people started a band. To us, the music was fantastic, and we wanted to imitate that. And what we were doing with Punk Magazine, you know, was the same thing.
Shiny, shiny, shiny boots of leather. Girl child in the dark.
One night, Legs McNeil came into the club, and he said, I'm Legs McNeil, I have to get in for free. And I said, it's $2, who are you? And he was like, you know, well, I'm Legs McNeil from Punk Magazine. And I said, well, if you give me a copy of the magazine for free, I'll let you in. And he said, fuck you, it's 50 cents, buy a copy at the bar. So I thought he had a really good attitude, so I said, sure, okay, you can go in. And that night I went to the bar after I got off work and I bought a copy of the magazine and I went home and I read it, and it was just the funniest thing I'd ever seen. In the CBGB scene, nobody was calling anything punk until it was late in 75 when people started seeing these stickers everywhere that said, punk is coming, punk is coming. And then when it came out, it was a magazine called Punk Magazine. And because that was the key organ that was covering all of these bands, that sort of became punky, punk attitude, punk this. And that really that's where the whole punk thing came from, was calling it that. It just was a lot of different people that got lumped under this one umbrella because Legs McNeil was foolish enough to name the magazine Punk.
We just came along and said, okay, we're calling this punk. Which nobody, the Ramones did not want to be called a punk band. Blondie didn't want to be called a punk.
I'm in the phone booth, it's the one across the hall. If you don't answer, I'll just bring it off the wall. I know he's there, but I just try to call.
We'll be hanging on the telephone.
Debbie was in, you know, she starred in two of the Fumettis. One, she played one of the Nazi dykes with the machine gun. Was a small part, but then the next one she starred in Mutant Monster Beach Party with Joey. The plot of Mutant Monster Beach Party was Debbie and Joey were lovers against their parents' wishes. And Debbie was on these special pills that if she didn't take them, she would turn into Edith Massey, who was one of the John Waters stars.
Oh, I can't control myself.
It had everything. It had violence and monsters and machine guns. And, you know, Debbie was really in the whole spirit of the thing.
And Debbie was actually the hip girl who hung out every night, you know, and actually had a Mustang convertible and would give everybody a ride home.
Hang up and running. Oh, hang up and running. Oh,
Well, you best believe I'm in love, L-U-V.
In America, I could play New York and L.A., and that was it. Especially me, because I was considered a transvestite punk singer. Went into middle America, we'd be murdered, we'd be shot.
Well, I always saw you just before the dawn, when all the other kids were just dragging along. I couldn't believe the way they looked to me. Remember the things they used to say to me. I gotta keep on moving, I wanna have some fun. Gotta have some fun. Yeah, I gotta keep on working till all my work is done.
I would do a song, and I had, you know, these big black dildos, these big cocks I'd shake, and had a cock gun filled with milk, and I had a song called Goddess of Wet Dreams. I would shoot the audience with, you know, with the penis gun, you know. I crawled into a casket and fucked a dead body. I was like, oh, stupid, you know, stupid. Back then, people said, it's art, it's fabulous art.
Just looking for a kid.
And I had a song called Shit. It wasn't just a song screaming about shit. The song, the lyrics were about how when everyone, it don't matter if you're royalty or you're the Queen of England or you're some homeless bum, you got to shit just like me. Hello. So I brought this toilet out and I sat on the toilet. And I had before, you know, went to the store, of course, and bought Alpo dog food. Now, Alpo dog food looks like shit. It's horrible. And so I would empty it in the toilet, and then I would do the song, I've been shit, and I'd pull down my pants, I've been shit with the mic, I've been shit. And then I would get up and go in with my hands and take out the dog food, and people thought it was shit. People really thought I should shit in the toilet. And I would put it on my face and throw it at people, and I'd roll around the floor, and the guitars would go, and it'd be noisy and feedback. The band would be going like this with the guitar, and I'd be going, shit, 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 with dog food all over, and I'd lay on the floor, and then the band would start, and then I would go, and I'd pass out, and that was the show. Freaked people out, totally. People were just like, freaked out totally.
America's much bigger, so if you do something, it takes about 5 years for it really to get out there, and for kids to understand what you're doing. In England, it took off immediately, you know? And not only did they get what we were doing in New York, but, you know, if you listen to that Sex Pistols album, they were improving upon it, you know, which pissed us off.
There's no future in England's dream.
Everyone knows their rock and roll history. Now, before it was even called punk, it all started in New York City. But the British are famous for going into other people's scenes and stealing it and taking it back and making it British. And though I love my British fans, that is the truth. It happened in New York City. Das ist alles.
No future, no future, no future for you.
The New York scene wasn't a fashion scene in the way that London was. It was very much a originality and music combined. And there was an originality of a look, but nobody was thinking of it in terms of selling clothes, which the Sex Pistols came out of, you know, a scene that was very closely linked with selling clothes because their manager was a designer and owned a clothing store. Malcolm McLaren, who was in New York managing the New York Dolls, you know, he went and saw television, he met Richard Hell, he was aware of all these things.
This is what we call the zip shirt. Gives you plenty of easy access. Straps. You can strap it across like that. Grab your partner, you know. Do the strangle. Riot. And let's see, where's filth? Filth.
What happened in 1978 was the Sex Pistols toured America and came over here, and that was going to be the big introduction of punk, which is already storming England, and all these bands that had number one records were going to come to America.
Americans don't like something unless it goes to England and you sell it back to them.
Traffic light.
wasn't until the Sex Pistols toured in 1977 that punk really got out there to suburban America, you know? And by that time, it was over. I mean, the Sex Pistols came over, did this tour, got massive amount of media attention in America, and broke up. You know, which says to the record company, don't sign these guys, they're crazy. Because you'll spend all this money and this time developing them, and they're just going to break up anyway. So fuck them.
Sid Vicious came back and was living and managed by his girlfriend Nancy Spungen.
Hey, Michael, please. Just wake up.
Yeah, okay, I'll wake up. Right, now, what's the next question?
In 1979, Nancy was murdered in the Chelsea Hotel, and that also received a very large amount of negative publicity, obviously, because Sid was perceived to be the murderer, which he may well have been. Nobody really seems to ever have figured that out completely, but it certainly wasn't a very savory or family values kind of thing to attach to a music genre.
This is the body of a kid called Sid Vicious, a punk rock star with a penchant for violence, a murder suspect, a junkie, dead at the age of 21 of an overdose.
I don't think drugs, like, fueled the scene. It wasn't hallucinogenic music. It wasn't driven by drugs necessarily, but drugs became a big part of the scene and took a lot of casualties.
No, I don't believe in luck.
There was a sort of sense in the earliest days among the greater number of the bands of sort of common purpose. I mean, we were all seeing each other every night. We all lived at CBGB's.
I saw you walking in the dark. So I slipped behind your footsteps for a while. Caught you turning around the block.
That initial period, that first era at CBGB's, ended by 1978.
Accidents never happened, could have planned it all. Precognition in my ears.
Scenes are made to be like anything else. They're made to be broken. Scenes are created by people, and the people go their own way, and the scene is ended. Thank God, you know.
I think it was also, it was a little too wild, you know, and a little too crazy, and people weren't getting it. You know, suburban kids really didn't get punk in America until the 80s, and it really didn't start to sell until the 90s with Nirvana.
It's dangerous, you will know, and it's dangerous, I'm stupid, and it's dangerous.
it survived, and in fact, not only has it survived, it's flourished, and it's gone on to inspire, you know, everything from, you know, The Simpsons to Beavis and Butthead to, you know, Married with Children, you know. None of this stuff would have happened if it wasn't for punk first. The thing is, you don't want to be first in America to do it because you don't make the money.